Hey everybody, got a new video for you today. I've actually meant to do this for about a week, but stuff's been there. Stuff's been crazy. Just give you a quick update since the last video, and we're going to get right into it. So since we last talked, we did a lot of videos on stocks and things like that. And if anybody's watched these videos for a while knew that I am not a trader in stocks. Things are going normal. Do not listen to me at all. But when you get something crazy happening in the economy, I think that's where I shine and I make a lot of money. And obviously, when COVID hit, I decided to make videos just so you could walk through it with me. And anyway, the whole intent was it was to pay for law school. So one of the reasons I haven't done a video in a while was because I've been in law school and the schedule is absolutely nuts. And that was one of the reasons I didn't do it for the last week, is I just got so busy and I was sleep deprived. But anyway, since then, one of the things we've done is at the very top of the market, we actually sold our house. And this is a little bit about the part of the video, but it's part of a background as well. So, gosh, I want to say it was March of this year, I was outside with my neighbor and I saw one of my neighbors, another neighbor had their house for sale. And this neighbor actually, a couple of years ago, came up like nose to nose and like threatened to beat me up. Now, I'm 6'3", and I really don't think that was going to happen. But anyway, when I saw the house for sale, I'm like, oh, great, addition by subtraction. And so we were talking about what the house would go for. And I got to think about 2 years ago, that house was going for about 600,000. It's the exact same floor plan as we have. So it's like whatever they sell their house for is going to be what our house is worth. And that seems a lot of money, and it is, but in California, the numbers are just kind of crazy. And so I was asking my neighbor Alex, and I'm like, what do you think it's going to go for? And I'm thinking it's going to be like seven or something. And so I told him like 725, and he looked at me like I had three heads. And I'm like, well, what do you think it's going to go for? I'm like, he said, well, at least eight minimum, which blew my mind. That's a stupid number. And so I just blurted out to him, and I'm like, if it goes for nine, my wife and I are going to have a serious conversation. Now, she's lived in this house for 16 years, not really somebody who's that fond of change, and so the idea of moving was just anathema. And so that house ended up selling for 908, and so we had that conversation. And I was telling her about the fact that, look, you're not going to see this again. Rates are going up, and this is before all the crazy rate hikes happened. And basically, when rates go up, the prices go down. It's really that simple. And so you have a certain amount that people have to spend on housing and a certain amount of interest, and the rest is principal. When you spend more on interest, you spend less on principal. Just basic economics, which is what we're going to be talking about in earnest today. And so, long and short, I finally got her to list it. And so I was talking to the guy, and he's like, yeah, the people that did 908, they don't even know how to sell that house right. He goes, I'll definitely get more. And I'm like, what do you think? And he's like, 930, 940. And I'm like, I'll tell you what, if you get two commas, I'm going to buy you the most expensive bottle of wine. Again, I just blurt this out. I didn't think about it. And long story short, it went for over a mil. And so I had to go like hit up one of my friends who owns a liquor store, and we went to his wholesaler. And I had to get the most expensive bottle of wine they had. So anyway, we moved out of our house. New background, as you can see. This is basically the house we're not buying again right now, because that would be crazy. So we're renting this house. Got a really cool view out in front of me, but it's at night, so you can't really see it. Great for background lighting though. And we're waiting for about a year or two. I'd say 2 years before we're going to buy again. And the whole idea was we're selling it now and we're going to pocket that money and we're going to sit on it and we're going to wait till the housing goes down, then we're going to buy a place by the beach. I used to live by the beach. I used to live by the beach right before I got married, and so I definitely miss it and want to go back. So anyway, we got the money in literally in CDs. I mean, it's like the opposite. My wife's like, you're not putting that in the stock market. And I'm like, I know, like this is, the opportunity for the stock market started in the beginning of COVID. It didn't start now. But we're going to talk a little bit about that. And so Little do we know, the end of April, I think it was like April 30th, was when the house sold. So if you decide you want to pause this video and go look at interest rates, the little chart, you'll see where April 30th was. I think like less than a week later that the crazy rates started going up. And so it's at a point where we actually looked at a house that had a very similar, I mean, same square footage. I presume it's the same floor plan. And instead of 1 point over a mil, it's going for it's listed at 775, and it's been unsold for 36 days, which means that housing price dropped over 200 grand in what? Let's see, August, July, June, May, 4 months, something like that, which is just insane. So maybe we actually are going to move that. We might have to be moving that beach house up a little bit. But anyway, I wanted to talk to you about something because I had been saying this to people. I'd been watching the news, just listening to, different shows of every political persuasion possible. And just with my background, not in economics academically, I've taken one econ class in my life. But my knowledge and expertise on econ and just, knowing how things work. And obviously, we've seen what happened with the stock market, and I called pretty much everything when it happened. And so one of the things that I was talking to my dad about, who, by the way, today is his 85th birthday. So that's pretty cool. And he's in Savannah, Georgia. So he just missed spending his 85th birthday during a hurricane. And I was talking to him about basically the economy, the recession, like the recession and the cause of it and what to be done. And so we kind of got into a little bit of a disagreement, but we like not arguing, like negative arguing, but we definitely like, kind of mentally going at it. And so I was telling him, and I know he's wrong about this because when I'm going to tell it to you, I literally had somebody, like two people on major podcasts have guests on and explained it exactly the same way I'm going to explain it to you. So anyway, I told him, I said, look, there's two types of recessions. So as you're looking to make decisions on what you're going to do, first of all, you want to, no matter what you do, you want to keep your powder dry, save money. This is not the time to really take a lot of risks. You want to save money, keep your powder dry, because there's going to be some major opportunities coming up to make money. I was watching Ben Shapiro, and one of the things he said, he's totally right, because this is the story of my adult life, is he said, the only time, pretty much, when all the rich people make money is when the economy tanks and goes down. And the reason behind that is basically because if the economy is going up and everything's just doing amazing, everybody makes money, but nobody differentiates themselves from everybody else. So if everybody else is going like this and you're going like this, you're not gonna get any richer than anybody else. Because guess what? If you do what everybody else does and it goes down, it follows the same thing. But what you want to do is you want to keep your powder dry and wait and really wait for the right opportunity. But in order to find the right opportunity, you have to understand what is going on and why. And so we're going to talk a little bit about economics. And what's crazy is like usually the word that follows economics in most people's vocabulary is wonk. It's these people that try to make economics really, really difficult and really complicated. And I'm going to give you the easiest economics lesson that you can learn. And that when you watch the news or you're listening to a business show on the radio or watching TV or what have you, or you're reading an article, I'm going to give you a quick way that you can interpret what they're saying and what econ means. And I'm going to talk to you about what the government's doing and why it's the exact opposite thing that's going to work, whether they're doing it intentionally or it's absolute complete negligence. It doesn't even matter. All right, so we're going to talk about a little bit about economics. First thing we're going to talk about, everybody knows, it's the law of supply and demand. And so typically, when demand goes up, this is how they do pricing in economics. And I'm not going to get complicated. This, again, it's going to be super easy to figure out. You have supply and demand. If you have supply go up, in other words, you have, I just saw this crazy animal that ran in front of me. When you have supply go up, in other words, somebody just comes out with a whole bunch of stuff and nothing else changes, the price goes down. Okay? And that's like an abundance. I forget the term they had for that in econ. But then on the opposite side, when you have supply go down, that's what they call, was going to say shortage, scarcity. And so let's say, for example, you're in a like a hurricane, right? Hurricane goes through. I had this happen in Miami and all the power went out, right? I mean, literally the power went out. There were no gas stations working, no ATMs working. You go to a store, they're not taking credit cards. I mean, it's just, and so what happens is power becomes scarce. And so they had these people that would drive down from Georgia with a 24-foot truck full of generators, and they were just gouging people. So, you know, let's say a generator costs $200, they'd be selling it for $1,000. But you're going to buy the generator because you don't have a choice. Okay, so when supply goes down, the price goes up, all things being equal, right? Then you look at demand. And I'm talking to you about this because we're going to make this really simple. I want really to understand what supply and demand are and then how to interpret it. So let's say everything's equal, but demand goes down, right? So think about when they invented the MP3 player or the iPod back in the day. It's like, well, the demand for CD players is going to go down. Why would you want a CD player when you can get something better, right? And so demand goes down, which means price is going to go down, right? If not a lot, if fewer people want something, the person that's selling it is probably going to take a bath on it, right? On the other hand, if demand goes up for something, everything being equal, the price is going to go up. So again, look at those generators. When you lose power, there's a much higher demand for buying electricity or power than there was before because you had power in your home, right? All right. So when it comes to recession, there's been all this, and this is the meat of what we're going to talk about today. When it comes to recession, there's basically two types of recessions. It's really simple. I mean, what's crazy is Biden and all these people on both sides of the aisle arguing, are we in a recession? Are we not in a recession? Kind of doesn't matter. But let's say we are, right? Or if you don't even have to use the term recession. But when the economy goes down, there's basically two sides. And I'm just going to say recession just so we can define it as the economy going down, right? There's two types of recessions. One is a demand side recession, and the other is a supply side recession. And nobody talks about this, but they're very distinct. The cause of them is totally different, and the solution for one is not the same as the other. In fact, if you have one, a solution for the first one, let's say a demand recession, and you apply it to a supply side recession, things are going to go in the crapper in a heartbeat. And the same thing, if you have the solution for a supply side recession and you are in a demand side recession, it's going to go in the crapper. So we're going to talk about this today. Me and my dad were talking about it. And I said, listen, I said, this is a supply side recession. And he's like, no, it isn't. You know, come on. Like, okay, you're 85 years old. And he's got his wits. So it's not like you're 85 and you're like not thinking straight. It's just you're 85 and you think that you know more than your son and you've been around more. Which, by the way, when I turn 85, I 100% am going to be the same way. You know, if somebody's 30 some odd years younger than me, I'm going to be like, you don't know what you're talking about. But in this case, he doesn't. And the reason is, like, one, I studied it. And two, all the money that I've made in the last 20 years is because it's based off of what I'm telling you. So he can say what he wants. But my bank account and what I've done in my life is completely based on the fact of my belief in what I'm saying. And if I was wrong, well, nothing would have worked out. So anyway, I was telling him, I'm like, we're in a supply side recession. Now, what that means is that the recession is caused by a lack of supply. Okay. And so in the current recession right now that we're talking about, the supply is basically initiated by labor. Okay. When you don't have people going to work or when things shut down, you're going to have a lack of supply. So just think stuff we all went through, the toilet paper shortage, right? All the different shortages that we had. They had like steak shortages, but the toilet paper shortage is a perfect example. When you have something that goes down, the cost of it goes through the roof and people get desperate, right? And so what happens is you have, it causes inflation, okay? So look at toilet paper. If all of a sudden you're a store and you normally, like whatever thing of toilet paper that you have, let's say it's 10 bucks. Well, if you have a shortage, outside of just not wanting to piss off your customers, and you're the only person that has a ton of toilet paper left, you could charge 20 or 30 bucks for it, and people are going to buy it because it's going to sell like this. Okay. So we're in a supply side recession. You have people that aren't going to work. On one side, you have this whole quiet quitting thing, which is really stupid. That's going to end up for these people really poorly down the line. Don't quiet quit. But then the other side, and this is really the focus we talked about, is it's a government-induced shortage. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, a government-induced shortage is one where the government decides we're going to pick winners and losers by industry, and we're going to just start shutting them down. And so, like the petroleum industry is the first example of that in a heartbeat, where they just said, okay, we're not gonna, first of all, we're gonna shut down the pipeline. Secondly, we're gonna create all these onerous rules that make it really impractical to do it and raise the cost of doing business. And lastly, and this is where you hear a lot of sparring, but it's all for rhetoric, is they'll say, oh, well, the government comes out and says, oh, well, we just opened up, 2 million acres for, drilling oil leases. And it's like, okay, well, yeah, you can do that. But these people have to, if you know anything about the petroleum industry, is these people have to go there and they have to go to banks to finance the expenses to go drill. Because not every time you drill, you're going to find oil. You're drilling because you're hoping you're going to find oil. It's like buying a lottery ticket, right? So hopefully you're going to have better odds than that. And so they have to go to the banks. But the problem is the government has basically, the agencies that oversee the banks have basically made it, they're doing this ESG thing where they're basically making it onerous on the banks to lend to anybody in the petroleum industry. And so, yeah, you can get a lease, congratulations. You can't do anything with it, though. And so what happens is petroleum is like way down or is way upstream from everything else. And so if there's no petroleum, then it affects everything going forward. And so you have a situation where people aren't going to work for one reason or another. And then the petroleum industry is, they're basically not drilling for oil the same way. And we have to go basically buy oil or beg for oil, which is what's happened from Iran and Venezuela and all these other countries. And so what happens is the cost of things go up. And so you start to see inflation because there's a lack of supply. And then what happens is it cascades. So people aren't working, the petroleum's going, supply's going down, and so the price of things go up. Well, then all of a sudden, when the price of things go up, people start pricing things differently, right? So I'll give you a good example, the auto industry. Who's going to sit here and buy a car when it's a 7% interest rate? First of all, like they're not even making, there's a chip shortage, which is another shortage issue that we haven't really talked about. But who's going to buy a car when you have a 7% interest rate? Who's going to buy a house when you have a 7% interest rate? I mean, you're just not going to do it. And so then what happens downstream is you start to see people lay people off. And they've always said, well, the jobs are all there. Yeah, but that's all downstream. So anyway, you have this situation where the lack of supply is driving inflation, and then inflation is causing other people to not invest as much and slow down. And so what happens is, and you can read this when they talk about the Fed, is they're like, oh, we got to keep raising rates so that we can knock down inflation. It's like a pinata. Like, okay, we have this pinata here, and we just got to do everything we can to knock down inflation. And if it means we have to wipe off the economy, then so be it. Remember when I said that if you have a supply side recession and you apply the wrong kind of solution, it'll screw everything up? Well, that's what they're doing. So we talked about supply side recession. We're going to talk about a demand side recession. That's the bad one. That's the one that you just really never want to see. And a supply side recession could actually cause a demand side recession. So what is a demand side recession? A demand side recession is one where people aren't spending money. Okay? They aren't spending money. There's a lack of demand overall. People, stores have all this stuff and people just aren't buying it, right? It could be gas, it could be groceries, it could be electronics, it could be cars, and you know where I'm going with this. People have stuff to sell and nobody's buying. Why aren't they buying? Because they have no money. Or they have money, but it's the margins are thin and they don't want to spend the money out of fear that if they, like, they just won't have any money left over. The demand side recession is the nasty one. I mean, that's the nasty one. You never want to have that. I mean, that's what makes depressions. That's a lot of what happened in the 1930s. It was a demand side recession. People had no money. And so when that happens, you have to raise interest rates. And what happens is you raise interest rates and it causes people to save more money, to keep their money. And that spurs, that basically spurs people, you know, to not, you know, it basically knocks a lot of the things that people bought at a low interest rate, and it brings it back where it forces people or encourages people to keep more money. Okay, that's not what's happening right now. A demand side recession is one where it's like people don't have money, and that brings us me to exactly what we're going to talk about. When you hear supply and demand, it sounds crazy, and there's all kinds of, like, econ people love having charts of all this stuff. And I actually took two econ classes. I apologize. I took two econ classes in my life, and it's basically the same thing. And they try to make this, it's like baseball analytics. They try to make it super complex, but I'm going to make it the easiest thing that you can ever understand. You ready? All right. Whenever somebody says demand, all it means is, and you can replace it, just literally replace the words with one for the other. Demand means people's money, okay? Or people willing, their money that they want to spend. But generally, it means people's money, okay? And then supply means stuff. So just think of a store. All the inventory in the store is supply. And then the cash in your pocket or the cash in your bank account is demand. And so what happens is, if you have a supply side, if you have a demand side recession, it means, what does demand mean? It means people's money. What does a recession mean? Really low amount, okay? So if you have a demand side recession, the easy translation is people don't have a lot of money, okay? And so what do? Well, you raise interest rates. Because what's going to force them to stick money back in their savings account? Because right now, like 4 months ago, nobody had, the interest rates were zero. Why would you even have a savings account? It's stupid, right? And so people would lend money because it's like borrow money because it's 0%, and they knew they could always make more money. So why save it? It's stupid. And so when you have a demand side recession, you raise rates because people aren't spending any money anyway. You're not going to kill the economy by raising rates. People aren't spending money. And so you want to induce them a reason for people to save. Okay. And that's the only way to really get out of a demand side recession. You know, demand side recession, again, people don't have any money. Now, supply side recession, we're going to do the translation again. Supply side means stuff to buy. Okay. And that also means labor. So it just doesn't mean like stuff in a store, but labor is a supply. If you have a restaurant and you're growing, you need to buy people's labor. You need to hire people. And so a supply side recession, let's do the translation, is people don't have enough stuff for other people to buy. Okay. That's a supply side recession. So what you want to do, and let's all say it together because you know what's coming, a supply-side recession, the cure to that is give people more stuff to buy. So if supplies are low, and I'll give you an example for wages, right? If it's hard to hire people and nobody's hiring and nobody's signing up for your job and coming to work and you're paying them, I'm just making up a number, 15 bucks an hour, it means you're going to have to pay them 20 bucks an hour, right? You increase the supply. You pay them more and you increase the supply. So when you, the cure to a supply side recession, in other words, people aren't buying enough, if there's not enough stuff for people to buy, you have to increase the supply. It's that simple. If people are running out of toilet paper, well, that's a supply side, not recession, but that's a supply side issue. What do? You make more toilet paper. I mean, it's really that simple. And then the problem's fixed. Okay, and we saw that during COVID. So now that you have the super easiest translation, we're going to talk about what the government's doing and why it's a big problem. So we're in a supply side recession. People, it's because there's a lack of supply. Either people aren't working, which is a big problem because when you have too few employees, you can't make as much. If you're a restaurant and you need 20 people and you can only get 10, you're not going to serve as much food. And so you're not going to spend money on inventory or advertising or anything else. And, you know, you're not going to be as successful. But if you're, you know, if you know that you can get inventory and you can buy inventory and wages and, you know, labor and all that, well, then you're going to make more money, right? You solve the supply side problem and everything goes down and the prices go down as well. So what is the government doing now that we're in a supply side recession? They're increasing interest rates, which is stupid. So what does increasing interest rates do? It makes the cost of borrowing go up, which means if you have a line, if you're a business and you have a line of credit, which a lot of businesses do, and you raise the interest rates, it means that the amount of money they have to spend toward as an interest payment is higher than it was before. And that's money that has to come out of somewhere else. And so usually it's going to come out of wages first or, you know, the capacity for them to sell one way or another. So their gross amount of business will go down as a result, right? Now, we're in a supply side recession. And again, we're in a problem because there's too few stuff to buy. And so you raise interest rates and it's going to lower the amount even more. And so you start seeing these interest rate increases of 0.75% and 0.75% and 0.5%. And it's just making things worse. And so what happens when you take a supply side recession, in other words, a problem because there's not enough stuff for people to buy that they want to buy, and you start increasing the interest rate, you create a shortage because people stop producing, which just makes the problem even worse. You take a supply side, I don't have enough stuff that I want to buy, and I have the money to do it, and you keep crunching down the supply, it's going to drive the price up. So let's take a look at what's happened. Well, inflation's gone through the roof. Duh, shocker. You take a supply side recession, there's not enough stuff that I want to buy out there, and you reduce the supply even further, guess what happens to the price? It goes through the frickin' roof.
That is an absolute disaster. And I think it's really important to underscore this was the intent. Like, this was the Fed's intent, was to cause exactly this situation and to try to effectively crash the housing market. But again, if part of your issue here is a supply issue, by increasing the rates, and that's what this Wall Street Journal piece really points out, you're also causing additional supply issues. So exactly the problem that spiked inflation to start with, you're actually exacerbating by increasing these rates as well. So it's an ugly situation. I want to get to the other piece of this, which, you know, the other goal of Fed policy was basically to, like, lower wages and slow down the labor market. The, you know, there was lots of angst in the corporate world about the quote unquote tight labor market. Let's go ahead and put this up on the screen. It looks like those policies are just starting to bite. They say, this is from the New York Times, less turnover, smaller raises, hot job market might be losing its sizzle. Unemployment is still low and hiring is strong, but there are signs the frenzied turnover and rapid wage growth are abating. Let me read you a few of the facts that they have in here. They say Americans in July quit their jobs at the lowest rate in more than a year. The UN is calling on the Fed and other central banks to halt interest rate increases. A UN agency warns further policy tightening risks a global economic downturn. And these effects can compound very quickly. There is a lag between when interest rates are hiked and when you see the fallout economically. So in the same way that we had this massive supply chain shock because of the pandemic and also exacerbated by the war in Ukraine, they're saying all of these banks tightening at once could have a similar compounding disastrous fallout effect. One of the things, one of the quotes here that you have from the guy who was in charge of the team that wrote the report, he says, "Do you try to solve a supply-side problem with a demand-side solution? We think that's a very dangerous approach." Now, to take that out of, like, econ speak here, you know, the reason we ended up with this inflation was all of these supply shocks. Raising interest rates doesn't deal with that whatsoever.
Okay. So why am I saying this? Because you've made money. Well, if you've watched my videos and you've followed me, then you've made money. If you haven't, fine, that's cool. we're gonna pick up right now and we're gonna give you the best lesson you've ever learned. If the people who are running things are taking a supply side recession and making it worse, which is like trying to put out a fire with gasoline, that's exactly what they're doing, then you need to be very careful. You need to keep your money, okay? The problem is they're applying a demand side recession problem. In other words, I don't have a lot of money. That's what demand side recession means, to a supply side problem. Well, when you take a supply side recession and you apply and you make a demand side solution, you know what you get? You get a demand recession, which is way, like I said, it's way worse. And so the best thing you can do when you're in a demand side recession is you need to keep your money. But the problem is by then it's probably too late. And so you need to start now. So what am I doing? Well, we sold our house and we cleared more money than I want to say, but it's not our money. My wife, literally, we have it in CDs. Like, we're not going to like touch it. We have it firewalled off. But it's like in a year or two, maybe even sooner, who knows, when you start to see that demand side recession come in. And again, I'm just going to redefine this for you. We have a supply side recession, meaning I have money. I mean, some money, a lot of money, little money, but I have money where it's not a problem necessarily. It's not a life or death. I can't pay rent and I'm going to get kicked out of my house problem generally. But there's a shortage of stuff. Or if you're a business, there's a shortage of labor. There's a shortage of stuff that I'm going to spend money on. And so really what they need to do is they need to like put more out there. They need to encourage people to work, which means kicking them off whatever government thing they're on, which means, I don't know, I mean, there's a million things to do, but supply side, you need to make more stuff. You know, for the car industry, you got to figure out how to get chips out there. I mean, this is freaking ridiculous. Like, there's no way in the world you should have to wait a year to get a car. I mean, that's crazy. So when you take that, the solution is make more stuff. It's really that simple. And you don't do it, but you supply a demand side recession problem. The thing is, you get a demand side recession. If you have a demand side recession, you apply a demand side recession problem. In other words, I don't have any money, and we're going to try to do something to make you keep your money. Then that kind of works, but it takes a long time. It's not something that you can do really quickly, because demand, all it is somebody that loses confidence, and they're not willing to part with their money anymore. That's really hard to deal with. I mean, think about it. If you've ever been broke, and I have, I mean, really poor and really broke. I used to literally feed fake money into the bus in high school because I didn't have any money. I mean, that's demand recession. I used to not, like, we still didn't have any food. We called them ghetto steak sandwiches. It was literally white bread and A1 sauce, and that was my meal. That's troubling because it's like a trauma-inducing thing, and it's really hard to get out of, and that's what the Great Depression was. Well, the only way to get out of it is a demand-side problem or a solution, which is, you know, is driving interest rates up. We saw that in the 1970s. In 1981 or 82, the interest rates were like 18%. It was the only way to get out of it. But the problem is they kept raising interest rates, but it was still a supply-side recession. And I'm not getting into too much, but like that's when there was gas shortages, right? I mean, that's the perfect example of that. And so if you have that supply side recession, in other words, like I have money, but there's not enough stuff out there, or it's too freaking expensive, there's no way I'm spending money on it, then, and you start raising interest rates and applying that demand side recession, you're going to get a demand side recession, which is really, really bad. But the only people that get rich off of that, and there's a huge opportunity to do that, are people that understand that ahead of time and are saving their money and are keeping their powder dry before the demand side recession comes. And then when it comes, it's a trauma. It's like COVID. You see people wearing masks and like, I mean, you either had COVID like 6 times or you've had 6 vaccinations or whatever it is. There's no reason to wear a mask. I mean, like it obviously didn't work one way or the other. Because either the vaccines worked or they didn't, and you got COVID. So it's one of those things happened. But that's going to be a problem. And the next huge thing that's coming, okay, 2 years ago, 2.5 years ago, it was COVID. And we went through the videos. You can watch all my old videos. And that was the opportunity to get rich. And I told you I'm in law school because of it, right? Don't get any sleep. But The next one that's coming is the demand side recession. It's going from I have money, but there's not enough stuff out there to buy or to pay for, especially if you're a business, to I'm losing all confidence and there's no way in the world I'm spending my money, in which case you have all these businesses out there that need you to spend their money on them, and the population as a whole is not going to do that. Well, what happens when that happens? Well, businesses go under. People lose their jobs. You know, they talk about the employment rate and they're like, well, you know, we gained all these jobs. That's a bunch of garbage. Don't listen to the employment rate on TV because it's a misleading stat now. Normally it's valuable, but it's a trailing indicator. Now, a trailing indicator just means that by the time you see it, it's too late. So it's like a tsunami, right? Like the water trails all out and you're like, oh, that's really cool. That's really, you know, crazy. I can walk where there used to be water. And then you see the big wave on the horizon and you're like, what's that? By the time you see the wave, it's too late. And that's what the jobless numbers are and the employment numbers. They're a trailing indicator. And people are like, oh, well, we're gaining jobs. Like that is it's not a lie, but it's such a facade. By the time, what's going to happen is people are going to lose faith. It's going to become a demand side recession. And then the job losses go through the roof. And that's what we saw earlier in COVID. So anyway, two easy takeaways for I want you today. Number one, whenever you hear recession, just understand, forget about the technical definition. That's just people that are arguing and economics wonks and people that are on TV. When you hear recession, all it means is it's going in the dumper. Okay, it's a problem. Just think problem, recession, problem. When you hear demand side or demand, but when it comes to economics, it means my money. My money. Demand side recession means I don't have any money. Okay. When you say, oh my gosh, demand for something is going down, it means people don't have the money to spend money on it. I mean, it's like they don't. They don't have money. They wish they could buy it and they won't. And guess what happens when you have a demand side recession? Violence. Like that's when people really start to get crazy and desperate. So if you don't have a concealed carry permit or if your state allows you to have it without it, great. But I would make sure that you have a plan for your own personal protection one way or the other. Now, demand side recession means I don't have any money to spend. That's a huge problem. And it affects how you look at things and you start to be a really penny pincher, which really you should be at that point. A supply side recession means I have money. I have no problem spending it. But there's not enough stuff out there. And then the price goes through the roof and you start to say to yourself, why am I spending money on something that's this frickin' expensive? So when you hear supply side, that's stuff to buy, stuff to spend money on. Demand, it's my money. And so we're in a supply side recession and right now you need to keep your powder dry. So what am I doing? Well, I'm doing two things. One, we have money in CDs. Right now they're earning 4%. You know, the new ones we're putting money into, but it's probably going to hit 5 or 6 pretty soon. So I'm not really going to go into long-term CDs going forward at all. So, and we're going to look, you know, in whatever amount of time, about a year or two to do that and buy a house. And by the way, I was watching a podcast and they literally said the same thing. They were like, this is where you get rich. This is where the people that are rich make their money. And then about two, you want to shut down buying assets as long as you can. And then in about 2 years, that's when you want to buy. And I literally took that. I took this little earpiece, put it in my wife's ear, and I played it for her. And she goes, wow. I go, who told you that? And then like 6 months ago, your husband told you this. And she's like, yeah, you did. You're totally right. And so you want to keep your powder dry. If you don't have a lot of money, that's fine. Okay. But you want to know what's coming. Think about what would happen if somebody told you that there's going to be a crazy recession. I mean, maybe depression. And I'm not sitting here telling you hours or days or months or years, but it's coming. What would you do? Well, you'd save money. You'd cut your expenses as much as possible. And if you have money, you'd make sure that you cannot lose it. Okay. I spent 2 years going through COVID and showing you guys how to invest. Right now, I'm telling you not to do that. Okay? You want to keep your powder dry. And then when it comes, you want to be one of the very few people with money. You want to be the type of person, it's like the end of Trading Places, where everybody wants to sell and you're the only one with money to buy. Why do I say that? Because I've done it before. I was sitting here in 2011. It was June of 2011. And it was literally the bottom of the housing market after it crashed. And so we're driving around. I actually had money out. My career was going great. And I was one of the very few people that was actually looking to buy. And so I ended up buying a place that was I bought it for $380. And right now it's worth almost $1 million, maybe more than that. So as a, I'll put the video up and I'll show you exactly what the listing is or whatever, so you can see how much it's worth. I don't know it offhand, but it'll be somewhere around there. And so we're looking to do the same thing. We're looking to save our money, buy a beach place that we want to retire on, at a low amount. And then I'm in law school because that's my solution. You know, I want to be in a situation where I have a job where I can make good money and be in demand. So high demand, higher money, right? And be in a situation where it's a little bit impervious. So anyway, wherever you're at, doesn't mean that's what you have to do. But people watching my channel while knew that's kind of where I was going with this. But just understand two things. Number one, supply. Supply means stuff that you have money and you want to buy, right? If it goes down, it's a problem, but it's easily fixable. It's super easy to fix. I mean, we could end this problem in a minute. And then you have a demand side recession. Demand just means my money. And so when you have a demand problem, it means you don't have any money. And that's the one that's a big problem. And if you have supply, if you apply that supply side solution or demand side solution to a supply side problem, which basically means raise interest rates, drive the shortage even lower, the inflation is going to go through the roof, businesses are going to stop spending, businesses are going to close, companies are going to start laying people off, and then you have a demand side recession because people don't have a job. They have no confidence, and that's the big problem. And if you're one of the rare people that has dry powder at that point, that is where people get rich. So I'll try to put some videos at the end of this. So I'm glad that you watched all the way through and just some clips of what people are talking about that echo what I'm telling you. So with that being said, I have wills and estates homework that I have to do. And this video is longer than I wanted, but it's something I really wanted to do for a while. And I wanted to take a lot of the stuff that you see, the rhetoric, it's an election year, and all the garbage and propaganda that you hear. I'm an advertising major. All advertising is propaganda, so I'm used to filtering that through. And I wanted to give you something that was really simple and a really easy piece of advice to go forward. Because right now, you need to keep your powder dry. And there's going to be a point in time that I'm going to keep your eye out. I'm going to put more videos out. We're going to give you ideas on exactly what to do and when to move on it. But for right now, I'd say keep money wherever you can. I would put money no more than probably a 3-month certificate or a month certificate. Usually the rates are about the same. So if you can get a 3-month or a 1 month, get a 1 month and make sure it's not auto renewal, basically. Because there's banks out there that are going to be absolutely desperate for money, for like investment. And not all of them are, but they're going to give you crazy rates and crazy offers. So with that being said, keep your money, keep your powder dry, keep your money invested in something that you cannot lose it on, but just know it's coming. I mean, they're literally spraying gasoline on a fire. It's like Idiocracy. They're pouring the sport drink or whatever, Powerade drink or whatever it is on the plants, and they're shocked that the plants are dying. And then right now what's happening with Biden is all this, I don't think he's doing it. He's mentally gone because he's had strokes. But like the people that are out there, whether it's intentional or negligent, are literally applying the exact wrong solution to the problem. And it's making things dramatically worse. And either they are just obstinate and they refuse to admit they're wrong, or maybe it's intentional, or maybe they're just idiots and they don't even understand that what they're doing is wrong. Which I'm kind of thinking that's probably my leading candidate there. But anyway, this is the opportunity where people get rich. These are the opportunities to do it. Do not follow the herd. But listen to what I'm saying. And this is the opportunity to get rich, because I'm telling you right now, in about 2 years, first of all, 2 years I'm graduating from law school, but 2 years, less than 2 years, actually, a year and a half from law school. But in 2 years, I'll be making, you know, more money than I did before, and we'll be buying a house on the beach. And maybe it might be faster if these idiots keep throwing gasoline on a fire. But you know what you want to do right now. So whenever you hear supply, just think, stuff I want to buy and I have money and I'm willing to buy it, but there's not enough. And then demand is just my money. So right now we're in a supply side recession. There's not enough, you know, we want to spend money, but they're not making stuff for me to sell, for me to buy. And then demand side recession, that's the bad one, is where you don't have any money and you're screwed. And I don't want you to be there. So anyway, if you have any questions, let me know. If you don't subscribe to my channel, make sure you do that, because we're going to put stuff on here that you literally will not hear anywhere else. Put a comment in. I answer all my comments. Any questions, any suggestions, any ideas for a video you want to see. But that's it. I appreciate your time. I'm going to go study wills, literally wills. That's what we're doing today. And we'll talk soon.
To get more information on the sales cheat code, go ahead and click on the subscribe button below. Also, down below in the video description, you know, down there, there's a link that takes you to our website that gives you additional content, some additional freebies that we have, and gives you information on some programs that we have that have been proven to help people to make sales easy so that you can make the kind of money you want, live the lifestyle that you've always wanted, and not have to struggle in the process. And what might be the coolest thing of all is you don't have to put much effort into it. It truly is a cheat code that most people don't know about. And it's a cheat code that can change your life today. So click on the link below and let me help you start to experience these results starting right now.
That is an absolute disaster. And I think it's really important to underscore, this was the intent. Like, this was the Fed's intent, was to cause exactly this situation and to try to effectively crash the housing market. But again, if part of your issue here is a supply issue, by increasing the rates, and that's what this Wall Street Journal piece really points out, you're also causing additional supply issues. So exactly the problem that spiked inflation to start with, you're actually exacerbating by increasing these rates as well. So it's an ugly situation. I want to get to the other piece of this, which, you know, the other goal of Fed policy was basically to, like, lower wages and slow down the labor market. There was lots of angst in the corporate world about the quote unquote tight labor market. Let's go ahead and put this up on the screen. It looks like those policies are just starting to bite. They say, this is from the New York Times, less turnover, smaller raises, hot job market might be losing its sizzle. Unemployment is still low and hiring is strong, but there are signs the frenzied turnover and rapid wage growth are abating. Let me read you a few of the facts that they have in here. They say Americans in July quit their jobs at the lowest rate in more than a year. The UN is calling on the Fed and other central banks to halt interest rate increases. A UN agency warns further policy tightening risks a global economic downturn. And these effects can compound very quickly. There is a lag between when interest rates are hiked and when you see the fallout economically. So in the same way that we had this massive supply chain shock because of the pandemic and also exacerbated by the war in Ukraine, they're saying all of these banks tightening at once could have a similar compounding disastrous fallout effect. One of the things, one of the quotes here that you have from the guy who was in charge of the team that wrote the report, he says, Do you try to solve a supply-side problem with a demand-side solution? We think that's a very dangerous approach. Now, to take that out of, like, econ speak here, you know, the reason we ended up with this inflation was all of these supply shocks. Raising interest rates doesn't deal with that whatsoever.